Come, whoever you are. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Venice, Florida, where we strive to be the church home where differences are celebrated. We discern truths from the world's religions and philosophers as we are guided by our seven principles. We're called to lives of service as we seek equality and justice for all. I welcome you to rise if you're able and sing the opening song, Come, Come, Whoever You Are. It's number 188 in the hymnal, but it'll be up on the board also. Give you a shortened version this morning. You may be seated. We just wanted to make sure all your knees still work. Welcome today, and I wonder if we have any visitors who are here for the first or second time. If you'd like to say your name and where you're from. Yes, Jim. Reading, Pennsylvania. Jim, welcome. Welcome. Also, the offering will take. Oh, we have somebody else. Yes.
I'm Unitarian. I'm originally from Chicago, but now I live here on the island.
Elise?
Yes.
Nice to meet you, Elise. She's from Chicago, or was from Chicago. We would like to take the offering now, and we'll do it. We don't have any announcements. This is like a very unusual occurrence. We will now have the prelude by Lisa Frank. It's Dizzy Fingers, and we didn't write down the man's name. Oh, yes. Z's Confrey. Now, that's an interesting name.
Thank you. Actually, I have a small announcement. Well, maybe it's not such a small announcement. In case you missed the news, Sunday afternoon I tested positive for COVID. And I'm fine. I haven't run a temperature since Tuesday. I finished my isolation protocol, but I'm still on mask protocol, which is the reason I'm hiding up here instead of coming down and being friendly. I'll be friendly next week. Till then, accept my love from a distance. We come to this time and this place to rediscover the wondrous gift of free religious community, to renew our faith in the holiness, goodness, and beauty of life, to reaffirm the way of the open mind and the full heart, to rekindle the flame of memory and hope, and to reclaim the vision of an earth made fair with all its people one. We light this chalice this morning to symbolize the light of truth and goodness, the fire of justice and commitment, and the warmth of compassion and community in our congregation and in the world beyond these walls. And just by way of introduction to hymn number 149, you probably know, but just in case you don't, it is also known as the Black National Anthem. The first time I heard it, I didn't know that. I just thought it was a really cool hymn. And then later on, somebody told me. And there's a difference, maybe worth mentioning this, there's a difference between homage and cultural appropriation. Homage is when you appreciate the culture that developed something. Cultural appropriation is when you just use it and don't worry about that. So, as an homage to the culture we're celebrating this morning, I invite you to stand as you're willing and able and join in singing hymn number 149, Lift Every Voice and Sing.
Thank you.
be seated. We have a responsive reading this morning. As always, I invite you to, I will read the straight type, and I invite you to respond with the boldface type. Let religion to be, let me try that again. Let religion be to us life and joy. Let religion be to us a dissatisfaction with things that are, which bids us serve more eagerly the true and right.
Let it be the sorrow that holds us back, and the understanding.
Let religion be to us the wonder and lure of that which is only partly known and understood. Let religion be to us security and serenity because of its truth and beauty, and because of the enduring worth and power of the loyalties which it engenders. Religion uniting us with all that is admirable in human beings everywhere. Holding before our eyes a prospect of the better life for humankind, which each may help to make actual. And our choral response this morning is number 374 from the Gray Hymnal, same melody as the doxology. Kathy Avery also has COVID. I'm guessing she and I got at the same place. And she also has the flu, and she's not with us today, so we don't have a children's moment exactly. However, we do have a film clip that I asked Tom to show, and I'll tell you a story about my dad. This is from Oscar Micheaux's movie, The Sign of the Unconquered. Circa 1920, he shows a gathering of the clan. They're about to attack the hero. There's the hero's girlfriend, mind you, riding to the rescue to notify him that they're coming. That's quite an outstanding scene filmed on 1920s era, well, pre-1920s era film. My father was born in 1915, the same year The Birth of a Nation came out, and the Ku Klux Klan was virtually non-existent in 1915. By 1925, it had a membership of over upwards of 5 million men plus a women's auxiliary. When he was 10 years old, and I might add that my grandparents grew up Roman Catholic. Their parents were Roman Catholic from Ireland. One of Dad's cousins joined the Ku Klux Klan, and my grandfather had some pretty sharp words for him, because in eastern Iowa, where they lived, there were very few black people. There were very, very few Jewish people. There were Catholic people. And the Klan had to pick on somebody, so they were picking on Catholics. And so my grandfather had some pretty specific words to say about that. And a few nights later, the Klan paid him a visit and burned a cross in the front yard of their farmhouse. Consequently, Dad never thought much of the Klan after that. And the way he described it was a great deal more like what you just saw than the way D.W. Griffith portrayed it in The Birth of a Nation, because D.W. Griffith, as I'll mention in the sermon, portrayed it pretty much as a medieval knightly tournament. And these guys were night riding terrorists, although they were very respectable in the daytime. So, Oscar Micheaux was making movies on a shoestring, but he was depicting real life in a way that the big Hollywood spectaculars never did. And that's what I would have told the kids if they were there. And if there are kids watching, it's worth thinking about. And hopefully we'll all have fun and learn something. Sorry, I'm still just a little bit froggy. So, again, being careful up here. And because I'm being careful up here, I'm not carrying the mic for celebrations and sorrows this morning. Pat Wellington's going to carry it, but this is the moment in our service when we share the trials and tribulations and joys of our lives. So if you have a trial or triumph to share, raise your hand and Pat will come to you.
Your friend Venice said. We are very happy to be entertaining my niece, Patty Solick, from Cape May. She's here for a week.
Wonderful. Well, Patty.
And Pam. Hi. I think most people know it, but this young gentleman here turned 79 early this morning.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear
Richard.
Happy birthday to you.
Anybody else? That's a hard act to follow.
You're going to make me work.
This is both a celebration and a sorrow, all built in one. But this is Pat and my last Sunday with you until next fall. We will join you as best we can from New York State through the summer. But you know, it's through joy we're going to go to New York State and sorrow that we will leave you. See you next year.
This seems kind of silly, but I'm super excited. My older daughter for 3 years has been trying to work on a visa for her now newly husband from UK. And because of COVID and embassy closures and everything else, they finally got the last piece of paper signed this week and everything will be uploaded to the State Department. And we're hoping that they'll be here early next year. So I'm very, very excited to be able to see my daughter again.
And your name, please?
My name's Janet.
Thank you so much, Pat. Yes, it is a morning's exercise some mornings. We lift up those who travel forth, who are journeying, who are missing loved ones in other ways, those who are facing life's milestones and leaping over life's hurdles, and hold within our hearts all who suffer or grieve or face challenges. We pray each in our own way. Into the silence. The hopes in this community are offered forth in the names of all those who have gone before, in the names of all those who will come after, in the names of all the helpers of humankind. Shalom, salam, blessed be, and amen. And I brought readings this morning from a couple of different film scholars' comments on black film director Oscar Micheaux. Tambay Obison on IndieWire.com writes, quote, why has Hollywood still not given pioneering black filmmaker Oscar Micheaux his due? Oscar Micheaux's legacy has not been entirely disregarded. Contemporary black filmmakers like Spike Lee have been vocal about Micheaux's influence. Lee even once called Micheaux his idol, who, quote, inspired me to do my first film. In 1986, the Directors Guild of America honored Micheaux with a Lifetime Achievement Award. In 2010, the U.S. Postal Service issued a Micheaux commemorative stamp. And yet, Micheaux has yet to be recognized in any way by the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, aka the most famous and prestigious organization in the film world. And this suggests either total ignorance or perhaps a lack of appreciation among Academy brass for what he was able to accomplish as a black man in Jim Crow America. But it's time to do something about it. Peter Sobinski writes on RogerEbert.com, Oscar Micheaux was a man with a life and career so astonishing that not only is it eminently worthy of documentary treatment, but if someone tried to pitch his life as a screenplay, there's a very good chance it might get rejected on the basis that his story was simply too good to be believable. He had a filmmaking career that would consist of more than 40 films, including Within Our Gates, 1920, A Blistering Riposte to the Birth of a Nation, and Body and Soul, 1925, which marked the screen debut of Paul Robeson, and which would be named to the National Film Registry in 2019. His career lasted until a couple of years before his passing in 1951, and makes him, in the words of one film scholar, quote, the most important black filmmaker who ever lived, close quote. And a word on our musical interlude this morning. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child, which almost everybody knows, and with me including them, almost nobody could name the person who composed it. His name was Samuel Coleridge Taylor. He was the child of a father from Sierra Leone and an English mother who grew up in England, I believe, correct, and then came to the United States. And like many a black genius in a very difficult era, because he was also contemporary with the Johnson couple who wrote Lift Every Voice and Sing, but he died young in his late 30s. But this is the music he wrote.
Thank you.
Last week, I explored Hollywood's first truly great movie director, D.W. Griffith, and his 1915 epic, The Birth of a Nation. And it was while I was doing research into the films of that period that I stumbled across what were known as, and still are known as, quote, race movies. In the silent film era, mainstream motion pictures rarely showed non-white characters, and when they did, as in The Birth of a Nation, they were played by whites in blackface makeup, usually as objects of ridicule or loathing. Movie theaters themselves were segregated, with non-whites restricted to a separate but unequal area, often a cramped kind of balcony above the balcony with a name I am not going to repeat, or blacks were excluded from that building entirely. But the humanity and aspiration of the oppressed will find ways to transcend the oppression. There was a need for motion pictures that featured black human beings, not just white invented caricatures. So in 1916, two Chicago entrepreneurs, George and Noble Johnson, founded the Lincoln Motion Picture Company to make films featuring black actors in realistic roles. They produced several short subjects, and then a young jack of all trades named Oscar Micheaux sold them the film rights to a novel he had written titled The Homesteader. As an entrepreneur himself, Micheaux was even more remarkable than the Johnson brothers. When his parents escaped slavery after the Civil War, they moved across the Ohio River and homesteaded outside the little hamlet of Metropolis, Illinois. There they enjoyed a high degree of integration for the Jim Crow era, including access to the school system. Farming 8 acres, the Micheaux family had income enough to send their children to the Metropolis school. Oscar was considered a good student, although he was criticized for talking too much and asking too many questions. Welcome to 19th century school. He was a strong extrovert and spoke easily to people. As an adult, he followed Horace Greeley's counsel to go west. He homesteaded a farm in South Dakota. He was a bit of a local curiosity there as a black farmer, but amassed 800 acres. And then during a drought, he took up novel writing, selling his books door to door. Oddly enough, he never learned to drive. He hired a chauffeur to take him from farm to farm, but he still turned a profit on his literary efforts. The Homesteader, his novel, was largely autobiographical about a black man homesteading on the Great Plains. And it attracted the attention of the Johnson brothers at the Lincoln Company, but the headstrong Micheaux, being Oscar Micheaux, demanded to direct the film himself. So the deal fell through. Undeterred, Micheaux raised money, got his hands on a camera and equipment, hired actors, and then drove to South Dakota and shot the movie himself. The Homesteader was the first full-length motion picture made by and for black people. It is now lost to history. No copies remain. But black audiences in 1916 were starved enough for films that reflected their lives. It turned a nice profit. Micheaux followed up with another full-length feature, this time writing an original screenplay in addition to producing, directing, and doing the camera work. He derived the title Within Our Gates, and this is the movie I recommend. It's on YouTube, I'll mention that later. He derived the title Within Our Gates from the biblical reference to the stranger that is within thy gates. As Leviticus puts it, if a stranger sojourn with thee in thy land, thou shalt love him as thyself, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. Now, for the record, Oscar Micheaux had a complex relationship with Christianity. He accused preachers of working to, quote, keep the Negro in his place, And sometimes, in fact, Micheaux's rhetoric might have fit into a Malcolm X speech 50 years later. But he knew his Bible. Within our gates was also long considered a lost treasure, and then a half century after it was made, a single damaged print turned up, mislabeled, in a film canister in, of all places, Spain. Sections of it were missing, and the intertitles, you know, the title cards, were the written dialogue, had to be retranslated back into English. On the other hand, the very fact that there was European distribution illustrates the energy with which Micheaux marketed his movies, which, like everything except acting, he did himself. This film is now also in the public domain and readily viewable, including on YouTube. You can just click on it. And I advise anyone who does want to watch it to read the synopsis first to make it easier to follow plot gaps. In a way, as you might already be figuring out, I'm kind of sharing my own journey in stumbling across this movie and viewing it. If the very word movie was coined to embody pictures that move, this one certainly moved me. Micheaux denied that his movie was a reply to The Birth of a Nation, but he could not have been unaware of D.W. Griffith's racism or The Birth of a Nation's violent social impact. And what's more, the dialogue in the movie places Micheaux and his main character squarely in the ranks of the uplifters for whom Griffith expressed such contempt. Now, I mentioned last week that Griffith made his biggest epic, Intolerance, about the evils of uplifters. Micheaux's movie constitutes the other side of the debate on that topic, with uplift as a key element of black aspiration before and during the 1920s. Like The Birth of a Nation, Within Our Gates parallels one storyline set in the North, Boston this time, against another set in the South, Mississippi, and it ends with a violent dual action sequence cut together in a manner also similar to The Birth of a Nation. Within Our Gates depicts the lynching, not just of the heroine's father for a murder he did not commit, but also her mother, just for being married to him, as well as the murdered man's black servant, just for talking about it. Griffith-like, Micheaux cuts between that and a different form of racial violence. As film critic Michael Glover Smith describes a quote, "This lynching scene is intercut with an equally horrifying scene where a villainous middle-aged white man attempts to rape the young heroine, Sylvia, before recognizing a scar on her chest that identifies her as his own illegitimate daughter." And the clever intercutting of this climax intentionally unpacks the racist ideology of Griffith's similarly constructed The Birth of a Nation. Close quote. For the record, Micheaux does not depict all white people as evil. He acknowledges and even honors the value of white allies. White mobs, however, are a constant demonic presence. This was a world of violence and potential violence, which blacks actually faced, which white people refused to acknowledge. Within Our Gates does not attain the level of movie magic of the D.W. Griffith films. It's more like a glorified home movie. How could it be equal to those films? Griffith had limitless funding plus experience directing hundreds of films before Birth of a Nation. Micheaux was writing, producing, directing, and usually sole crew member on only his second film, working on the thinnest of shoestrings. He introduces the heroine, Sylvia Landry, quote, "a schoolteacher who is typical of the intelligent Negro of our times," close quote. Sylvia is played by multi-talented Evelyn Prear, who would become an early star in the early 20th century black stage and screen. She is, Micheaux informs us, visiting in the, quote, North, where the prejudices and hatreds of the South do not exist, though this does not prevent the occasional lynching of a Negro, close quote. Sylvia is a somewhat mysterious woman. She's in the North to procure funding for the Piney Woods School in Mississippi, where she teaches. But she rejects advances from multiple black men, some of them real catches, because they're American. This includes ignoring the romantic cues of strong, well-educated Dr. Vivian. She tells him that she's just too busy to indulge in romance. Quote, it is my duty and the duty of each member of our race to help destroy ignorance and superstition, she tells him. Yes, Micheaux could get preachy sometimes. And then again, moral uplift was a strong theme in many race movies. Sylvia eventually does gain a promise of funding from a white philanthropist. Alas, the philanthropist is hosting a guest from the South who despises black people, along with any thought of educating them. Lumberjacks and field hands, that's all they're capable of being, she says. Let me tell you, it is an error to try to educate them. And this bigoted woman is portrayed by Bernice Ladd, an actress with a striking physical resemblance to Lillian Gish, the female lead in The Birth of a Nation. And again, this parallel is too remarkable to just be coincidence. I'm quite positive that Micheaux was having and sharing with his black audiences a little sly fun at Griffith's expense. It's not fun for Sylvia, though. Micheaux tells us, quote, during that sleepless night, she could think of nothing but the eternal struggle of her race and how she could uplift it, close quote. In the end, her work does pay off. The philanthropist sees through the Southern guest's prejudice and sends the Piney Woods School 10 times the amount they had asked for. So yay for that. Now, needless to say, even Oscar Micheaux was enough of a filmmaker, he realized someone sending a check to a struggling school is hardly a high-energy climax to a movie. So, to fulfill that function, Micheaux inserts this long flashback wherein Sylvia's friend describes Sylvia's mysterious past to Dr. Vivian. And that is where Micheaux depicts the lynchings, the attempted rape, and the revelation that Sylvia is the daughter of a philandering white landowner whose only decent act was to slightly compensate the unnamed mother by paying for Sylvia's education. And lest you think such a plot device is far-fetched, please remember that is precisely the relationship South Carolina Senator Strom Thurmond had with his illegitimate black daughter, Essie Mae Washington Williams, as revealed in 2003. This was not life imitating art. This was a black movie maker depicting a reality that was all too common in black life, which white audiences refused to acknowledge. And this still plays out in its own way in our own day. Each time a member of the dominant culture refuses to acknowledge a marginalized person's experience of marginalization, unless the marginalized person somehow overcomes a set of continually moving goalposts to prove it. People are experts in their own lives. Within our gate's closing scene also parallels The Birth of a Nation as Dr. Vivian asks Sylvia to marry him. Dr. Vivian loves Sylvia no matter her origin and implores her not to reject him just because he is American born. Be proud of our country, he tells her. We should never forget what our people did in Cuba under Roosevelt's command and later in France, from Bruges to Chateau Thierry, from Saint-Mihiel to the Alps. Be proud of our country, always. And that's when I burst into tears, watching this poignant mix of words that said one thing and pictures that reminded me of quite another. Micheaux was not just saying, be proud of our nation, though he did say that. He was also saying, be proud of our people. I, as a comfortably retired Euro-American, had to sit in humble awe before aspiration, resilience, and patriotism, a word that Micheaux actually uses, so huge, in the face of centuries of the racial horrors meted out to him and his people. Be proud of our country. At the same time, silent though the images were of loved ones lynched and burned for no crime and images of rape and murder without reprisal, I could not help but hear Micheaux crying out from a still too similar labyrinth of oppression in which marginalized people are still trapped in our culture. And I can only compare Micheaux's words with D.W. Griffith's whining, there's just no other way to put it, about censorship and persecution and attacks on his freedom of speech as he raked in millions of dollars for the birth of a nation. Unlike Griffith, Micheaux had to deal with the real thing. When Micheaux submitted Within Our Gates to the Board of Censors for a Chicago premiere, they banned it as too dangerous to show. After 2 months of negotiation, he was finally allowed to present it with the rape and lynching scenes removed. In other words, he was allowed to show only the first half of the film and then skip to the conversation between Sylvia and Dr. Vivian. Talk about the sanitized version. The comfortable version. Later that same year, Micheaux released the other controversial film I've mentioned, The Symbol of the Unconquered. This time he took on the Ku Klux Klan, and in common with his earlier films, The Symbol of the Unconquered is about blacks as homesteaders, and in this case, prospectors on the Western Plains. When corrupt white townsfolk learn that the black hero's land sits atop a valuable oil reserve, they send their night riders to burn down his holdings, frighten him away, and if necessary, kill him. Like Within Our Gates, The Symbol of the Unconquered was also considered lost for decades. This time, Belgium was the nation where a single print finally turned up. And I gotta say, Micheaux's distributive entrepreneurship just amazes me. Unfortunately, at least one reel of this picture still remains missing, the one showing the Ku Klux Klan attack on the black prospector. From the synopsis, black settlers drive the Klansmen off, throwing a hail of bricks and stones at them. At some point, apparently, the idea of the Klan being driven away by blacks, particularly in such a humiliating manner, was too much to bear for somebody who had custody of that print. So that reel got destroyed. But I'm sure black audiences loved it. The surviving footage, as you saw, does show the Klan writers gathering. And to me, that's a chilling scene. The evil gleam of the writers' hoods, torches burning, lightning-like flashes and streaks as they gallop past the camera on that slow exposure 1920s era film at night. Even filming that scene was a fair accomplishment. And again, D.W. Griffith filmed his Klan scenes in broad daylight, and he decked his Klansmen and their horses in white cloth with emblems of the cross. Again, more like a medieval tournament than a violent militia. Micheaux's night imagery to me is far more disturbing and also far more realistic. For the record, my undergraduate film history contained a long chapter on D.W. Griffith, calling him the father of film technique. Writing in the still segregated mid-20th century, film scholar Arthur Knight never mentioned the harm Griffith's torrent of offensive racial stereotypes caused. But as I documented last week, they got numerous black Americans lynched. And I spent 80% of my life not even suspecting that movies such as Within Our Gates or directors like Micheaux even existed. In a dysfunctional system, and this is the upshot, in the dysfunctional system, which America's racialized patriarchy still is, in a dysfunctional system, the dysfunctional is visible only to those held outside the system. You can't see it inside because I can't see it because I'm part of it. You have to work at it. And people like me never guessed what ethnic movies meant to the people who created and viewed them or the artistry that went into them. In the case of Oscar Micheaux, it was a dream of uplift where success followed ambition and determination, and where crimes prompted by no more than one's appearance were visible for what they were. And sadly, in the United States, where even today, institutional and individual violence still threaten the marginalized on a daily basis in various ways, that dream has proven elusive. And that makes his ideals just as poignant and important now, generations after he died, as they were when he was making his movies. Members of the dominant culture should respect, now as much as in Micheaux's time, the hope and aspiration that drove him, and the courage, and the hope and aspiration and courage that still drive uplifters in our own day. Blessed be, and amen. And I'll invite you to stand as you're willing and able, and join in singing our closing hymn, number 287, Faith of the Larger Liberty. Sometimes we have diversity of verses. The chalice is extinguished.
May the light go with us into the world.
Society is like a pyramid of sand, where people fear those trying to climb up from below much more than those kicking sand down from above. Is this not the sickness which gives birth to inhumanity? May we remember that nature put hands onto the ends of our arms in order that we might help one another up rather than push one another down. As we go from this place, may the glow of love and enlightenment guide our way, and may the rhythm of our footsteps soothe and bless the earth so long as we walk upon it. Blessed be.